Good morning. It's good to see you all this morning. I don't have any announcements regarding the service itself, except if you don't have a yellow sheet with the songs on it, please, Derek can get you one. So raise your hand if you don't have a yellow sheet with the songs on it. When I checked it this morning, had the music and stuff on there, but I didn't see any words or anything. So hopefully we'll be able to sing it still. Without, maybe the words are up on there, I don't know, but on my computer they weren't, so we'll go from there. With that, let's begin with our opening hymn, 10,000 Reasons.
Bless the Lord.
Oh,
Please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Working together with him, then, we appeal to you not to receive the grace of God in vain. Therefore, let us confess our sins to God, our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you and others by our words, our actions, and our thoughts. We have put obstacles in people's way. Our love is not always genuine. We do not always speak truthfully. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Behold, now is the favorable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, it is my privilege to announce God's grace to all of you. Our sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord, have mercy. They cried to the Lord in their trouble.
And he delivered
them from their distress. He made the storm be still.
And the waves of the sea were hushed.
Then they were glad that the waters were quiet.
And he brought them to their desired.
Let them thank the Lord for his steadfast love.
For his wondrous.
Let them extol him in the congregation of the people. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Please remain standing for our hymn of praise.
Sings and round me rings.
us pray. Almighty God, in your mercy, guide the course of this world so that your church may joyfully serve you in godly peace and quietness. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated for the scripture readings. Our Old Testament reading comes from the book of Job, the 38th chapter. Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, "Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Dress for action like a man. I will question you, and you make it known to me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Or who stretched the line upon it? On what were its bases sunk? Or who laid its cornerstone when the morning stars sang together and all the sons of God shouted for joy? Or who shut in the sea with doors when it burst out from the womb? When I made clouds its garment and thick darkness its swaddling band, and prescribed limits for it and set bars and doors and said, 'Thus far shall you come and no farther, and here shall your proud waves be stayed.'" This is the word of the Lord. Our New Testament reading comes from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, the 6th chapter. "Working together with him, then, we appeal to you not to receive the grace of God in vain. For he says, 'In a favorable time I listened to you, and in a day of salvation I have helped you.' Behold, now is the favorable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. We put no obstacle in anyone's way, so that no fault may be found with our ministry. But as servants of God, we commend ourselves in every way, by great endurance, in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, the Holy Spirit, genuine love, by truthful speech and the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, through honor and dishonor, through slander and praise, we are treated as impostors and yet are true, as unknown and yet well known, as dying and behold we live, as punished and yet not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, as having nothing yet possessing everything. We have spoken freely to you, Corinthians. Our heart is wide open. You are not restricted by us, but you are restricted in your own affections. In return, I speak as to children, widen your hearts also." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise. We will speak the Alleluia verse. "Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia, Alleluia." The Holy Gospel is according to St. Mark, the 4th chapter. "On that day, when evening had come, he said to them, 'Let us go across to the other side.' And leaving the crowd, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. And other boats were with him, and a great windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking into the boat, so that the boat was already filling. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion, and they woke him and said to him, 'Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?' And he awoke and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, 'Peace, be still.' And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. He said to them, 'Why were you so afraid? Have you still no faith?' And they were filled with great fear and said to one another, 'Who then is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him?'" This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated for our hymn of the day.
When I in awesome wonder
Of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, dear Lord. Amen. Our text for this morning is our Old Testament lesson as it was read earlier. Job is my favorite book of the Bible. It's the first book of the Bible I ever read. I read it for English class in high school. And so every time I get a chance to preach on Job, I apologize, but I like to take it because we don't get very many chances. So let me ask you, let's put up our next picture. Is this world getting better? Or is it getting worse? I looked up a few recent polls talking about this very topic, and according to recent polls, more than half of the people in the polls think that the world is getting worse. I looked up a couple other polls as well, and one poll told us that less than 10% of the people of the world, or technically of those polled, but they said of the world, less than 10% of the people think that the world is getting better. In the United States, 6% of people think the world is getting better. In France and several other countries, 3% of people think that the world is getting better. Is the world getting better or worse? Well, how about morally? Well, we've got wars that occur still, don't they? And other bad things that happen, and people are doing horrible things. Yet, on the flip side, there are some polls out there that say that discrimination worldwide is down. So that's a good thing. Is it getting morally better or worse? In some ways, maybe better. In some ways, maybe worse. Physically, is the world getting better or worse? Well, there's a lot of natural disasters out there, aren't there? Yet, on the flip side, Recent studies have shown that over the past 20 years, the ozone layer is actually doing better than it was prior to that, as well as things like infant mortality rate is way down than it's been in other times in history. So physically, in some ways, the world is getting better, but in some ways, it's getting worse. How about you personally, in your own personal life? Are you doing better personally now, as opposed to maybe a few years ago? I mean, the cost of living is way up. I was talking to several people while I was working out the other day this week, and one person said they're spending over $500 a week on groceries, and they're not living on steaks and lobsters either. I just saw a recent article that said that the cost for hot dogs in grocery stores has risen 400%. Except in one store, Costco. So go to Costco to get your hot dogs. That's the place to go. On the flip side, they're trying their hardest to make it so that people can have more time to spend with their families and things of that nature, and having to spend less time at work. So personally, I'm willing to bet that in some ways, personally, your life has gotten better in the last few years, but that in other ways, it maybe has gotten worse, hasn't it? Is the world getting better or worse? We have this tendency as human beings to focus on the negative, don't we? And therefore, we have this tendency to think that the world is getting worse, which is why over 50% of people think that the world is getting worse. 10% or less think it's getting better. Okay? When we start thinking that the world is getting worse, it makes it easy to start thinking like Job from the Old Testament. A lot of horrible things happened to Job, didn't they? He lost all of his wealth. He was the wealthiest man in the world, and he lost every cent. He lost his health. His children were killed. In fact, you could say with complete and 100% honesty, that all of the stuff that happened to Job is way worse than anything that's happening to us in today's world. It was only natural for Job to start doubting God a little bit, wasn't it? Now, he didn't doubt God's existence ever, okay? But he did doubt God's love. He did doubt whether God knew what he was doing, or whether God was doing the right thing. And so therefore, when Job would speak to God, when he would pray to God, he asked God to come down so that he, Job, could defend himself, so that he could tell God, hey, God, you know, look at all these horrible things that have happened to me. I didn't deserve this. I haven't been that bad of a person to have all of these horrible things happening to me. Instead of trusting God to get him through this difficult time in his life, instead of trusting him in the midst of all of these disasters that were happening to him, Job wanted to tell God what he was doing wrong. In today's world, with today's problems, and the world does have its problems, it can be easy to copy Job to a certain extent. Maybe not to the same level that he did, but we can copy him. We can doubt God. We can wonder if God really does love us. We can wonder if God really has a hand in what's going on in the world today. And if he does he know what he is doing? We can't help but wonder that if God is letting all of these bad things happen in the world today, then maybe he's not so much in control as we think he is, and we start to doubt him. It's kind of like we play an icebreaker game that I've played with the youth in the past, not recently, but in the past, where one person gets blindfolded, okay? And that person who's blindfolded has to trust somebody else in the group to lead them through an obstacle course that I created in the fellowship hall, okay? Now, that's easy to do when you're safe at church, right? With an obstacle course made by the pastor, by Joe, our DCE, previously. Because you know that Pastor or Joe weren't going to, you know, make anything really horrible in the obstacle course or anything like that. It's easy to do when you're safe at church, at a youth group function, having somebody lead you as with the blindfold. But what if you had to do that to cross a busy highway? Would you be willing to blindfold yourself and let somebody else lead you across that highway when you couldn't see a thing? That would be really hard to do, wouldn't it? To trust somebody that much. In the same way, it's easy to trust God when we're safe and secure, isn't it? When things are going our way, when we're in a place in our lives where, you know, we're filled with a lot of joy and happiness and good things and good times are happening, it's not so easy to trust God when a tornado destroys your home, when you lose your job, when a loved one dies in an accident, or you're diagnosed with cancer. It's not so easy then to wear that blindfold and let God lead us, is it? And it becomes extremely easy to start asking questions like these. What did I do to deserve this? You know, do you really love me, God? Why is this happening to me? Job asked those very same questions to God, okay, after his tragedies. He spent 30 chapters in the book of Job asking those questions and then having his three not so very bright friends trying to answer them for him and not answering them in a very good or comforting way. And finally, when we get to chapter 38, God finally answers Job. Okay? And he gives him a very peculiar answer. Okay? His answer is this: where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? In other words, God was saying, who are you to question me and how I run the universe? God is God. We are not. In fact, we're so far below God that you can't even measure it. So what right do we have to question God, to doubt him? He is the all-powerful creator of all things, including you and me. So what right do we have to question God, how he runs his creation? That was God's answer to Job in our Old Testament lesson for today. It is not a very comfortable or a comforting answer, is it? It's not the answer that we're looking for when we're asking God these questions, is it? It's not a very good, at least from our perspective, answer. We don't like it. But there's another part to this answer that God gives that I think does bring us comfort, or at least a different way to look at this answer that can bring us some comfort, and that's this. Since we are but human beings, we can't see the whole picture. We can't see the big picture. You could say we have a blindfold on, and we only know partially what's going on. But God, who created everything, can see the whole picture. He does see the whole picture, right? We weren't there when God created the foundations of the earth. We're not in Africa or India seeing what's happening in certain places throughout the world or Indonesia. But God is and God does. God knows the big picture in and out. We can only see our small little part of it. God knows that bad things are going to happen to us at times in our lives. As a matter of fact, he knows the very bad things that are the exact bad things that are going to happen to us. He knows that at times we're going to do bad things to others at times, whether gossiping about them or something else. He knows that we're going to doubt him. He knows that we're going to question him. He knows all of this. And he still chooses to run the universe his way. He knows we're going to question him. He knows we're going to doubt him. He knows that we're going to sit there and rail at him and say, God, you should be doing it this way. Don't you know what you're doing? He knows all of that, and he still runs it his way because he knows it's the best way. he still sent Jesus to the cross. He still forgives us all our sins and doubts. He knows things we might never know, at least this side of heaven, and he's in charge of it all. We are blindfolded in that we cannot see the whole picture. We need God to lead us by the hand. We need to let God lead us by the hand. And that's a very scary thing to do, isn't it? To let somebody else have complete control, even if that person is God. But let's go back to that highway for a moment, if you don't mind. Let's say that you did not have a choice. You absolutely had to cross that very, very busy highway, completely blindfolded and unable to see. You absolutely had to. Would you be more comfortable trying to cross that highway by yourself while you're blindfolded and can't see? Or would you be more comfortable having somebody who could see take you by the arm and lead you across that very busy highway? It's much better to have somebody who could see help us across, isn't it? When it comes to life in this world, we don't have a choice. We have to live in this world where bad things can happen at any time. And we live in this world where we are blindfolded in the sense that we can't see the whole picture. Would you rather walk through life alone? Or would you rather have God, who loves you so much that he died on a cross for you, lead you through this life, both the good times and the bad? Hopefully for all of us, the obvious answer is we'd rather have God lead us through. Amen. Lord, your word is a lamp to our feet and a light for our path. Amen. Please rise as we now confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We continue now by bringing our offering forward and singing our offertory, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus.
Oh, so
Not only did you lay the foundations of this world, but you created all of us as well. We are your dear children. And to that end, we pray on behalf of your dear children who need your loving and healing touch at this time. For those who are sick or injured or hospitalized, especially for Daniel, who will be going in to have a couple tests done this Thursday, we pray that they would be that the news that he will get from them will be good and positive, and that things will be going well for him. We pray for those who mourn the passing of loved ones, especially for the family of John Maynard, who we laid to rest this past week, that you would bring them comfort and peace in the time in the midst of their sorrow. We pray for those who battle against addiction, for those who battle against loneliness and depression, that they may know your peace and your love and your presence. Dearest Jesus, many are the times when it is hard for us to turn our eyes upon you and look full into your wonderful face. During those times when life is difficult, when life isn't going the way we want it to, it can be so difficult to trust in you and to let the things of this earth grow faintly dim. We pray that you would be with us during those times, that you would guide us, that you would lead us, that you would carry us through them. That we may get through them, and that we may continue to praise your glorious and wonderful name. Dear Holy Spirit, we pray for all of our blue-collar workers out there, for all of the skills that they bring to this world, for all of the hard work that they do, for taking care of themselves and their families, their communities, and their churches. We pray that you would watch over them and bless them, keep them ever in your loving care, and help us to be appreciative for all that they do in our society and in our country and in the world. For we pray this all in the name of our dear Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who has also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And Jesus awoke, and rebuked the wind, and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace.
Amen.
Please be seated for our closing hymn. Thank you.
Crown him the Lord of love. He holds his hands and side. Rich wounds at visible above in beauty glorified. No angel in the sky can fully bear that sight. But downward bends his burning eye and mystery so bright. Crown him the Lord of life, who triumphed o'er the grave and rose victorious in the strife for those he came to save. His glories now we see, died and rose on high, who died eternal life to bring and lives that death may die. Crown him the Lord of peace, whose power a scepter sways, from pole to pole that wars may cease, absorbed in prayer and praise. His reign shall know no end, and round his pierced feet fair flowers of paradise extend their fragrance ever sweet. Crown him the Lord of years, the potentate of time, creator of the rolling spheres, ineffably sublime. All hail, Redeemer, hail, for thou hast died for me. Thy praise shall never, never fail throughout eternity.
Again, good to see you all here this morning. A few announcements before we go our way this morning. First of all, tonight we are having our informational meeting about the National Youth Gathering at 5 o'clock here at the church. Any youth and their families, any youth that even has a slight interest in going and their families, please come and join us. Any adult who would be willing to serve as an adult chaperone or is at least interested in possibly being an adult chaperone, please come and join us here this evening at 5 o'clock here at the church. And any young adults that would like to serve as like a young adult volunteer or something along those lines, please come and join us as well. We will have information for you. That's what an informational meeting is for. So please join us here tonight. This Wednesday we have a church council. So if you're on the church council, please join us 7 o'clock this Wednesday evening. And then finally, my wife and I won't be here next Sunday. Actually, my daughters won't either. But my wife and I are celebrating our 30th wedding anniversary this week. And so we're going to be up in Michigan next weekend. Pastor Balgamin is going to do the service next Sunday for us. So please come and join us and as he leads us through worship. Finally, August 11th, confirmation students, 7th and 8th graders, and their families, please come and join us for an informational meeting about confirmation next year. That meeting on August 11th will take place immediately after church. I don't think there's any other announcements. Did I forget anything? All right, God's blessings on your week. We look forward to seeing you again next week.